Hello and welcome. My name is Artur Socha. I work at Red Hat as Senior Software Engineer. On a daily basis, I am responsible for extending and maintaining Ovid Engine backend, including SSO, OpenShift and KubeVirt integration, and JSON RPC communication modules. Today, I'm going to tell you a bit more about single sign-on capabilities of Ovid Engine. The presentation is divided into two main parts. In the first part, I will walk you over the main concepts and components that general authentication is built on. I will mostly focus on things relevant to Ovid Engine. The second part will be a demo showing how to configure external identity management provider. So let's start with the AAA module. The first A stands for the authentication, and just to remind you, authentication provides the answer for the question who you are. And because Ovid Engine is a web-based application, I'm going to focus mainly on the web-based authentication methods. You might already be familiar with the HTTP authentication that comes in two different flavors. The basic one, when the plain username passwords are sent over the network, and with the digest one, when the password and username is hashed and the result of the hash function is used. So you might think this approach might come with some security flaws. So over time, there was another approach developed, which is the bearer authentication, sometimes called token authentication. And I will cover it in a bit more details later. There's also a fourth option based on public-private certificates. When the certificates are distributed among users and the server is validating user certificates and based on the results, granting or not granting the access. We can also think about hybrid solutions, multi-factor authentications. They can even include some biometrics authentication methods. But for that, you need to have some sort of additional hardware. So the second A stands for authorization, which provides the answer for the question what you are allowed to do. And in this presentation, I am not going to talk about fine-grained permission models and the management of the permissions, groups, assigning permission for users to, for example, start or stop or modify VMs managed by Ovid Engine. No, I'm going only to cover the part that is responsible for allowing access to various parts of Ovid Engine. So, for example, Ovid Engine as a whole is composed of three parts. Well, I would say two applications and the API. So that is administrator panel, that is a VM portal, and as I mentioned, that is also the RESTful API. The third A stands for accounting, sometimes that can be called federated identity. And the federated identity in IT can be described by the means of linking a person's electronic identity and attributes stored across multiple distinct identity management systems. And Ovid Engine do have support for database as the storage for user attributes. It's done via JDBC driver, and the data is stored with the same database that is used for Ovid Engine to function to store the configuration. In our case, it's PostgreSQL. There is also a support for multiple directory servers. So here's the list of the implementations that we support. This is taken from the documentation, official documentation. And the third option is to plug in external identity provider. in our case based on OpenID Connect protocol. I'm going to talk about it later because this is the core of the second part of this presentation. So in order to achieve single sign-on, we need to we are using the tokens, and we rely on JWT, which stands for the JSON Web Token, and is a standard defined by RFC documents. And well, the general concept behind a token-based authentication system is quite simple. Allows user to enter their username and passwords in order to obtain a token which allows them to fetch a specific resource without using their username and password again. And once the token has been obtained, the user can offer the token, which offers access to a specific resource, for a time period to the remote site. And going back to JWT, this is the structured token, so it contains various fields. It can be signed, and we are signing the tokens. So this is the example of the JWT token extracted from one of the unit tests covering the token creation functionality in Ovid Engine. The decoded version contains several fields. They are defined by the standard, but there is also option to add custom ones if needed. They may contain information about the user, like the emails, usernames, information about when the token was issued, what's the expiry date, and things like that. So let's switch to the single sign-on part. What is single sign-on? This is a process that permits a user to access multiple services after going through user authentication, for example, logging in, and this happens only once. This involves authentication into all services the user has given permission to, after logging just into a primary service. Among the benefits, SSL avoids confirming identity over and over again through passwords or other authentication systems. So in order to have to achieve out, there is a authorization to achieve I'm sorry to achieve a single sign-on, there is an authorization framework developed, and it is also standardized by RFC documents, Open Authentication in version 2. It enables third-party websites or applications to access user data without requiring them to share their credentials. And it is a set of rules that makes access delegation possible. The user gets to authorize which resources an application can access and limits access if needed. Ovid Engine is actually implementing OAuth too, so it's one of the Ovid Engine is providing one of many available implementations. It's a minimum viable support implemented just to cover the needs of Ovid Engine. It covers authentication and authorization to administrator panel, to VM panel, to REST API. There are actually REST API clients available, like for Java, for Python, for Ruby, and also regular curl can be used to get the token and execute the API commands. So if OAuth is not an option, because for example in organization there is already a solution based on Kerberos or LDAP deployed, as Ovid Engine have a support for it. It's well documented. It requires only three different additional components: the standard Ovid Engine installation, the LDAP extension, and two Apache modules that supports Kerberos. So let's move to the more interesting option for this presentation, which is this external identity provider. It is also quite easy to add via two different components, but unfortunately the documentation is not as good as for the previous one, but there is ongoing work to fix it, to make it better. For now, there is a blog post written by one of the core developers of the authentication, authorization, and in general single sign-on options in Ovid Engine by Ravi Nori. So big kudos for him. He's not working on this project, but you know, Git remembers. The only thing that you have to remember is it was written for Ovid 4.3, and with Ovid 4.4 there were some not very big, but some significant changes introduced. So the naming in the configuration is different. I will show that in the demo. And the other thing is that for now we officially support KeyClock as one of the identity providers, but up to version 9. With version 10, there was some change that is not yet verified on our side. So what is OpenID Connect, the protocol that is being used for KeyClock to provide SSR? This is just a simple identity layer on top of Open Authentication 2.0 protocol. It allows clients to verify the identity of the end user based on authentication performed by an authorization server, as well as to obtain basic profile information about the end user in the REST-like manner. And OpenID Connect allows clients of all types, including web-based, mobile, and JavaScript clients, to request and receive information about authenticated sessions and end users. A few words about KeyClock. KeyClock is open source. This is very important, and provides the single sign-on capabilities, provides identity brokering and social logging. So, for example, your logins or accounts from various authentication and identity providers like Google or Facebook can be reused. It supports user federation with LDAP and Kerberos support. Things like database can be implemented and added to your KeyClock installation if needed. And it's based on OpenID Connect and SAML. It provides the user with a really nice admin console, UI admin console, or if preferred, there is also a REST API that covers the configuration. So now we are done with the first part. Let's move to the live session. And the live session will be showed using my own machine, where I have two different hosts, one for hosting engine and the other one for KeyClock. And the name DNS is resolved via etc hosts, so the simplest possible solution, not to make things complex. All the configuration, all the engine's configuration is stored in my GitHub project, so you can later on check it for yourself. So let's switch to the demo. Okay, so let's start with logging in into KeyClock console. I'm using already created admin username, just to access the console with the admin privileges. For the simplicity reasons, I'm not going to integrate any LDAP server, just for the user base. I will simply create users here in KeyClock. This is also still possible, so I will add user. Let's call the user demo and save it. Let's create a credential for it. I will choose the simple one, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I will just unselect the temporary switch just to not to be forced to change the password with the first login. So let's set the password. And in order to log in into Ovirt Engine's administrator panel, the user must belong to Ovirt administrator group. So I'll create the group as well. Ovirt administrator. And I will go to users back to users, and then I will add this group. I will add that user to that particular group. So I click join and it's there. Now we need to create a dedicated client configuration for Ovirt Engine. So I will create the client ID with name Ovirt. It can be the name of whatever choice you have. You can change it to anything else. We are going to use the OpenID Connect. And the root URL is the URL pointing to your Ovirt Engine host. So let's use the HTTPS Engine Demo Workstation. So let's click Save. And now I am going to change the access type to confidential, because it's not public, obviously. And one of the important thing is to just to change this valid redirect URIs so that it accepts the domain name with any port. It is important because Engine is building URLs adding even the standard ports. So for example, for HTTPS, that would be 443. So we want to make sure that Keyclock understands it and knows that this is also the valid URI. And the other thing we need to add or change here is the token lifespan. We need to do it because Ovirt Engine is managing token expiration by itself, so we don't want Keyclock to interrupt that process. So let's put there like 12 days or something. It needs to be a very long one. And let's click save. So now, once we have this client created, we may check the credentials. What's important here is that we are going to use the Ovirt as the client ID, and then this secret. We can regenerate it if we need, and then let's remember that let's copy that that secret. We'll use it later in the configuration. So next step is to create a mapper. So we need to map username and group to particular JWT claims. So let's start with creating a map for the groups, group membership. It will be called groups. And the token name is also the same. And we may click save, and let's create another group for the username, and we choose the mapper type of user property, and the property is also username. And we'll map it to tokens preferred username of type string. So we have it. Let's save it. This one is done. Now we need to prepare the client scopes. And there are three different client scopes that Ovirt Engine requires. So one is for the administrator panel. So we'll create the Ovirt app panel. App admin. So that's one for the administrator one, which is the OpenID Connect protocol, and click Save. And let's go back to the client scopes. Then we can create the scope for the REST API. So that would be OWIRT app API. All the remaining fields are exactly the same as previously. Let's go back again and create the VM portal scope. OWIRT app portal and click Save. Now we have those three different client scopes, so we can assign them to the newly created OWIRT client. So let's go to the scope tab, client scopes tab, and we can choose those client scopes as optional ones. So I'm using the optional fields because the scopes are not required to be passed all at the same time, because you can request only access to API, not to administrator panel. So let's choose the assign the scopes, and that's done. So now the KeyClock configuration should be ready. Now we need to move to engine host, and we need to install those two additional components. First is the HTTPD plugin for handling the Open IDC, and the other one is the extension for the authentication authorization or accounting module. So let's install it. I have already done it before, so they are there. And now we need to prepare the configuration on engine's host. So we'll go to etc OWIRT engine extensions D to prepare the authentication plugin. Most of the things here is can be simply copy pasted. The information, the one thing that for example might be interesting for you is the profile name. So you may decide to change it to something else, like a demo or something, but then you have to also update other files to be consistent with the naming. And the difference between OWIRT engine 4.3 and 4.4 when it comes to plugging in external open IDC provider is the naming. So the module name is different. It has been changed so that it is more consistent, but you can check the Ravis block for the 4.3 naming scheme. So this is the authentication extension configuration. Let's set up the authorization one. So this field, this configuration needs also to be created under this etc OWIRT engine extensions D. In the authorization, we also need to provide the mapping for the groups, and this one is used. This one is carried in token under the groups field. So this claim. Other configuration is simply very similar. In case you are actually integrating LDAP with KeyClock, then you will have to also provide the base DN of your organization of your choice. This one is done, and also one other thing is to prepare the mapping of how the usernames are mapped into the system. So this is also something that can be simply copy-pasted. So once this extensions authentication and authorization are configured, then we can move to set up the actual SSO endpoints. We go to etc OWIRT engine engine-conf D. We need to create additional configuration file there. And we are going to pointed to some of the endpoints provided by KeyClock. What's important, we need to point to user info. This is the endpoint that provides some additional info about it shows the properties, the user attributes, and also there is the token endpoint for just issuing a token, and the logout endpoint, which handles the redirections and invalidation of tokens. So what's important here is that we need to set up the external OpenAI ADC client ID to the one that we created in Kickoff console. So in my case, that is Obvirt, and we need to update the secret to the one that was generated. So let's update it to that one. Let's save that file. Let's move to the another one that needs to be created under engine.conf.d. We simply enable that external SSO authentication for Ovid engine, and we need to configure the logout URI here. And that's all of the configuration on the engine side. Now we need to set up OpenADC plugin for HTTP. It's the configuration defines various endpoints, for example this one that provides all the information about the Keycloak capabilities and the client's capabilities, and we can, in my case, I simply disabled the SSL validation because of the simplicity reasons, and here is the information. Here is the information about the client created, so it's Ovid as in previous engine configuration, and also we need to update client secret, and there is also another place where we need to do it for the authentication. The client ID is correct here, so we just update the client secret. And basically this file defines which resources of the Ovid engine based on some regex URLs matching are protected and which are not. Now once we have everything set up, let's try to restart the HTTPD and restart Ovid engine. Okay, so now let's test the entire configuration. Let's log in as the demo user, and it works. So we were authenticated using Keycloak. We're using the Keycloak login page and got redirected to the administrator, the Ovid engine administrator panel. So that's nice. And now I'm going to show you how to enable the two-factor authentication using one-time password. And this feature was discovered by my two colleagues, Andreas Bleischwitz and Jason Breitweg, who got in touch with me shortly before I was preparing this talk. So big kudos for them. In order to enable the two-factor authentication, we just need to add the required user action, configure OTP, click save, and if we just log out and log in, we should see the screen that with the instructions how to prepare the application. I already have a user with that enabled, so I will use it. And now we can see the one-time code input that allows us to enter the code generated by authentication app. And we are here. So that ends the demo, and I would like to thank you very much for staying with me for the entire presentation, and I will be ready for the questions just afterwards. Thank you.